Pantry Sunday is July 25th from 10 a.m. till noon, and we collected almost 300 pounds of food and $50 in donations in the month of June. And here comes Hunter. I haven't seen Hunter in a while. Hi, Hunter.
Yeah, no, he's naturally.
Thank you for your support for the food collections. We have an ad council meeting, and I think that's tomorrow, Monday, July 12th at 7 p.m. Still in person and on Zoom. Okay. Pastor Rosario went over the new CDC guidelines on singing at church. Is there anything you want to expand on that? Sing if you're not, if you are vaccinated and you have a mask, or you can sing without a mask. Can you explain some more?
Yeah. Basically, the guidelines are: if you have been vaccinated, you can sing without a mask. If you have not been vaccinated, please wear a mask. But we don't want to make this culture of vaccinated and non-vaccinated. So if you want to sing, it's better for everyone to wear a mask.
The Vacation Bible School that they were going to have at Rockaway has been canceled because they had low enrollment. They only had two kids signed up, so they have to cancel because they don't want to continue planning if nobody's going to show up. So that's canceled. Disciple Fast Track is still going. It's on a fast track, and it's going well. They have 7 p.m. on Thursdays on Zoom. If you're interested, you can call Dodie, you can call Pastor Rosario, and they'll share the Zoom link with you. And we're getting together with the youth, and we're still working on it. We have a list of activities that are moving forward, and we have dates now. And I think there might be a flyer out there somewhere. Dodie said she was bringing one out. Yep. Their activities are there, they're scheduled, they have dates, and more details will continue to follow. The last activity that's on there, I think it's on there, I'm not sure yet, we're talking about whitewater rafting, we're just going to get it approved by our insurance company before we move forward on that. We just have some questions we have to make sure they get answered, but I think they'll be okay, because the place I'm looking at will be able to check the boxes. Okay, so I think we're good with that. And if the kids are interested, have them call the office. They'll get a permission slip emailed to them, or we'll have permission slips here at the church. You can pick them up. It'll be a generic slip. You'll put in what the activity is. You'll sign off. You'll put the date. And we'll bring it back to the office so we have track of who's going. They have permission. So we're all in order, and we're covered with insurance. Okay? Okay, so please stand, and we'll do the call to worship. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it.
For he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place?
Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false and do not swear deceitfully.
They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation.
Such is the company of those who seek Him, who seek the face of God, Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Amen.
Come on in, Leonora, just in time for the children's message with Hillary.
Canoeing, right?
Canal.
Hunter, have you ever been out on a boat?
Canal.
at Niagara Falls. Oh, I'm going to talk to you about Niagara Falls after service, okay? It's fun, right? It's a nice way to spend an afternoon. So on our way back in, at the end of the day, we passed a family who was stranded. Their boat, they couldn't start their boat because the rope from the raft had gotten caught in the engine and they were having trouble, so they needed help. So we went to help them, got the rope cut out. The man was a little worried about starting the engine, so we ended up towing them back with our boat. We got a rope and we towed them back to the dock, and then eventually a police boat came and helped us out and kind of got them situated and on their way, and we ended up helping that family. So it reminded me, when I was thinking about the children's message today, it reminded me of a joke that I'm sure a lot of you have heard, so please indulge me, but you guys might not be familiar with it. So there's a story about a man in a house, and his neighborhood is flooding because there's a big rainstorm and the water's coming in and starting to flood the street. And he looks out on his porch and he sees his neighbors going by in a rowboat. And they say, come on, come on, come in with us in the boat, we'll help you. And he's like, no, I'm okay, I'm going to wait, God is going to save me, right? So then it keeps raining, the floodwater's getting higher and higher. He goes up to his second floor and he looks out the window and he sees a bigger boat, a rescue boat coming by. And the soldier says, sir, come on the boat, we'll help you. And he says, no, that's okay, I'm all right. God is going to save me. And then the rains come even harder and the waters are rising even faster and he has to climb up onto his roof. And now he's on his roof and a helicopter comes overhead and the Navy is in the helicopter and they throw down a rope and they say, stop, sir, climb the rope. We're here to save you. We're going to rescue you. He says, no, I'm good. God is going to save me. And then the floodwaters get too high and unfortunately the man doesn't survive. And he gets to heaven and he says to God, God, why didn't you save me? I was waiting for you to rescue me. And God says, really? I sent you two boats and a helicopter. What else were you waiting for? So the reason I thought of this story is because sometimes we need help, right? We're not able to do this world, this life all on our own. And sometimes we need help, but sometimes we're afraid to ask for help. Or sometimes we know we need help, but we don't recognize help when it comes to us. We're expecting Jesus to just walk through the doors and solve all our problems sometimes. And that's not really what's going to happen, right? God sends us helpers to help do these things that we can't do ourselves. And we have to be smart enough sometimes to understand and recognize those people who are going to help us, right? Those people who are going to help us in school, our teachers, our tutors, our parents with our homework, right? And when we're on a sports team, we have coaches to help us learn the game and learn the rules and help us be better, right? And in church, we have lots of helpers. We have our pastor and our religious leaders and our teachers and our church community and our neighbors. We have so many helpers around us. We just have to make sure we remember to ask them and recognize them, right? So will you pray with me now? Dear God, thank you for all the ways you help us. Remind me to remember to look for the helpers. Amen. Thank you.
Please join me in the hymn Amazing Grace.
My fears relieved.
concerns for this week? Yes.
I have a joy. I am happy that my brother made it to his 58th birthday today. 4 years ago, he was suffering with kidney cancer that spread to his back. He still has the cancer, but he's been in an experimental program with the military that has given him these last 4 years, and I hope they continue to give him at least another year.
What's your brother's name, Aaron?
Chucky.
Wonderful. Any other joys? Yes.
For a very successful Dance Nationals last week for Hunter's team.
Good job, Hunter.
And the fireworks went off way last night. We got to see a bunch of dance friends, a couple of other friends, and Pastor Amanda and my family.
So Hunter's dance team, Pastor Amanda's birthday, is that what you said?
Well, we're still going to have fireworks.
Oh, okay.
For birthday as well.
Rockaway, fireworks. Scared my dogs. All right. What else? Anything else? Yes.
I have a joy and it's a concern. I was recently selected one out of 14 candidates to be interviewed for the district visual and performing arts supervisor position in Randolph in the school system. So I got through the first round, and that's a big joy. And now my concern is to get into the second round. So I'm waiting to hear sometime this coming week if I've made it into the next phase.
Awesome. So the concern is to get into the next phase, or just the expectations, huh?
Yeah.
Wow, that's great. So it's the visual performing arts.
Right.
That's awesome. As long as we don't lose you here.
No.
Okay. Have you a weekday?
No, that's
okay. All right. That would be our concern. All right. What else do we have for joys? Any other joys this week? Jill.
Two more months. Girl gets married.
Whew, that quick?
Yeah.
Wow, I felt like it was just like a year ago. Wow.
Wait till next month. I'm really getting nervous.
Wow, so mom's getting married already. 2 months ago. Any other joys? Yes.
My mother's up from Tennessee, but she leaves today, so it's driving.
Safe travels and families here. Any other joys? Yes.
Well, being able to go on vacations again. We're going to go camping, and we're going to go to Villa Roma, which is our family vacation for as long as I've been alive. And we're going to get to see our family and happy to be able to have some of that, those traditions back.
Yes. More family and vacations and traditions that are coming back because we had them lost because of COVID. That's always nice. Having stuff come back. Any other joys? Yes.
Matilda will be performed next week in the Tabernacle. So if you've missed live music and live performances, get your tickets.
And where do we get those tickets, Hillary?
Online. I can.
Dodie, probably.
I think Dodie has the link, or I can post it in the.
Okay, so we'll see if Dodie can send out the link to Matilda. I saw the kids this week. They seemed very excited. They were into it. I didn't even notice Danny because he had a different hairstyle, different hair color. I was like, whoa, there's Danny. So yeah.
They're working really hard.
It was awesome in here. They have like a whole costume set up. Yeah. So if you can go support the kids at Tabor, that would be awesome. So Dodie will probably send out a link. That would be great. They were into it. That was a joy, seeing the kids this week here. It was nice to see the church in use and children in the church, youth in the church. It was amazing. I went in there and I thought, we'll see like 5 kids, but it was like a bunch of kids. I was like, floored. It was great. It was great. It was great. Wordless? Speechless. Yeah. Any other joys? Concerns? Mike?
A friend of mine, Ed, he's been going through some health issues. He's had some tests. He's gone for a brain scan today, so we're hoping to find something.
cancer?
Fred will start radiation.
Okay, so prayers for Bob and Fred and their successful treatment for cancer. Jill.
Wilbur still needs a few prayers for helping at the wound healing center tomorrow. We'll help him. Otherwise, there will be a divorce coming.
Did you say wound center? So Wilbur's going to the wound center and we need some prayers for him. But he's still giving you a hard time at home?
Of course.
So that's good, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, Mary.
David Jones, he's a Mount Tabor resident and he has not been doing well. Got some internal bleeding, I'm not sure what that's from, but just prayers that he gets better.
So David Jones, we're praying for his health?
Yes.
Is there any other concerns? Yes, Mike.
Wayne Englehart, his brother had passed away this past week, so I know kind of a little bit of a surprise.
Just prayers for Wayne and his family for his brother's passing. Any other concerns?
I've known some people that younger people that have been getting the Delta COVID variant and you know, it's COVID is still there, and we need to remember that and just be mindful and be precautious and take care.
So prayers for those who have gotten the COVID virus through the Delta variant, and for the people to become more aware. Just prayers for awareness that it still exists, and to just be mindful at that when we're still in crowds, we can wear masks and just be aware that it's still there. And it might come back because of this new variant. And the longer that, from what I understand, the longer that everybody doesn't get vaccinated, the more opportunity that there is for new variants to come out. Yeah. That's what I'm understanding. Jill?
Prayers for India. They kind of got roped on their virus shots.
They got what?
They got roped. They were given water injections.
Really?
Yeah, they paid money for the shots. And at least that's what I heard on the news.
Okay. So prayers for India. Hopefully they'll get better vaccines.
Yeah.
And prayers for good to win. Any other concerns?
Keeping prayer to people in Florida related to the collapse of that building. Those that lost their families, their friends, their homes, their secure place, their pets, and perhaps even the fear of living in fear that comes with that.
People in Florida and just loss of everything and the change they have to deal with now. And I'm almost sure that there's a lot of acute stress and maybe even acute stress disorder from that. Mm-hmm. And for the people that have helped out with the firemen and the all those people there that have helped out in every way, the people that have collected money and done things to help out, provide food and prayers for those people, and grateful for those people that are there. Any other concerns or prayers that we need?
Prayers for our church here at Mount Tabor, that we may keep being the light in the hill, and that our doors will be all open for everyone, and just pray for more, people and children and youth to come to the
these gates. So we can become a vibrant church once again. And prayers for our church. So we remain a vibrant church. And a church that's always open to all. And as we sung last week, that we make the circle wider and we're open to the youth and the children, and we keep having children and youth in our building because that was such a beautiful sight to see. And we remain the church on the hill that stays open and volunteers, because now that the COVID virus hasn't remained in our area right now, we can continue to do the work that we were doing before and continue to do it with the open heart that we've had. What I saw before the COVID virus was showing on in this church, because it was a beautiful thing, and it still is. Any other concerns or joys? Okay. Lord of the dance of life, you have breathed into us your creative, joyful spirit. You have lifted us from the dust into the swirling joy of your presence. The joys of birthdays of Mary's brother, Chucky, the fireworks in Rockaway, Hunter's dance team doing really well, the joy of Ned doing well in his visual performance arts the first time. We're going to pray for him to do well a second time and get through it without too much expectation. For family that is here and going to have safe travels going back to Tennessee. For vacations that we used to take before COVID in our, is it Villa Roma?
Villa Roma.
Villa Roma, and traditions that we missed before COVID. For Ronnie, 2 months to go in her wedding. For the children that are here in our church doing Matilda, let's support them. God, we are so grateful for that, that you have what everything that you've done for us. Each day reminds us in many ways of your mercy and your love. Yet there are times in our lives when we have felt lost and alone. We have been hurt and frightened and wondered where you were. Remind us again of your loving presence. Place your hands of healing on our lives. Comfort us when we become afraid, lost, lonely, and fearful. Prepare us to serve you faithfully all our days. As we have lifted the names of dear ones to you who are indeed of your healing love, we have Ed, who's Mike's friend. We're praying for his health issues and his brain scan. We're praying for Mike with his arthritis. We're praying for Bob and Fred with their cancer treatments. We're still praying for Wilbur, who's going to a wound center this week. And we still want him to be ornery. We're praying for Wayne and his family who are dealing with the loss of a loved one. We're praying for Dave Jones, who is a Tabor resident. We're praying for his health issues. We're praying for those people who are still getting the Delta virus in COVID. And we're praying for people's awareness so that they know that it's still out there. So we need you to be aware and protect yourselves and your families. We're praying for the people in India who didn't get a fair shake. We're praying for good to take over evil. We're praying for those people in Florida who have to start life over again from nothing. We're praying for them to be able to do that with you standing there next to them, God. We're praying for our church here in Mount Tabor to continue to be the light on the hill. We want to be able to keep our doors open and invite more people into your building here and into your church. It's not just about the building, God. It's about you. It's about bringing Jesus into your heart. We want the children and youth. We want more people. We want the people of our town. We want the people outside of our town to be here and to know you. Be with us now in this time and this place and in all places and times of our life. Let us pray how Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
morning, everybody. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him, you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal and the promise, the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The word of God for the people.
I don't know about you, but I'm one of those people that believes that I'm a glass half full person. But our human nature usually tells us that the glass is half empty, and we never have enough. The author of Ephesians will help us turn our human nature around by showing us that it is God who graciously fills our glass until it is overflowing, and it is God that gives us more than we could possibly need or imagine as we set our hope in Christ. Dr. William Barclay has called the book of Ephesians the queen of the epistles, and he admits that he got it from others. Why so much enthusiasm for a letter? There are simply too many things to go into in this space. But perhaps the simplest response is that the letter contains everything we need to explain the faith in one compact package. There is some considerable debate about the letter. Many, if not most, scholars argue that it wasn't written by Paul. It also seems clear that it wasn't really written to a specific church in Ephesus, despite the title. But it was a circular letter designed to be passed from church to church and community to community. There are none of the usual personal touches in this letter, as there were in other letters, addressing local issues and individuals, which for some means that it comes across more as a sermon than a correspondence. Even though it may not be Paul who wrote this letter, the story of how Paul came to the city of Ephesus is interesting. And it would be a wonderful homework assignment this week. It would give you a really nice background into Paul's history in Ephesus. You can read about it this week in Acts chapter 19. So if you want to write that down or put it into your phone, you can do that. Acts chapter 19, because we're going to be doing a 7-week series on this letter to the Ephesians. So you'll have a little background on how Paul did ministry in Ephesus from Acts chapter 19. Right, Jill? There you go. All right. It was the epicenter of worship for most of the Roman and Greek gods. For over 2 years, Paul had a really effective missionary presence there, and lots of people became followers of Jesus. It is thought that maybe Paul, if he did write the letter, wrote it in prison. Through Jesus now, anyone could be adopted into the family, into our family. In fact, the author, Paul for short, says that grace has opened up a whole new way for us to understand every part of our lives. God's plan was always to have a huge family of restored human beings who are unified in Jesus. Jesus is the salvation, and through him, we are all also brought into this family through the work of the Holy Spirit. So let's dive in so we can see how the book of Ephesians begins with a powerful, positive message. You are good. You are chosen. We are. We are good. We are chosen. And we are part of the family. Perhaps some of what was useful to the earliest church will also be useful for us. And maybe we can find in this letter some wisdom to help us live more fully into our Christian identity, to be confident in what we are and in our role as Christ's disciples. Quite simply, everything that is bad in us is taken away. And in Christ Jesus, we are made new. Just let that soak in for a minute. It's nothing short of a miracle, and it's amazing. We cannot be effective workers in God's kingdom or kingdom if we do not first have confidence in our status as beloved children of God, as people made new in Christ's love. Do you believe you're new? You're made new through Jesus? I do. I know I was made new. So as the writer opens his letter to the young church in Ephesus, he begins with a reminder of God's gracious claim on every person there, a claim which extends even to us, even now. I think it's fair to say that from time to time, we all struggle with doubt and shame. We question our self-worth and our ability to fulfill God's calling upon our lives. I do it every time I have to write a sermon. I question myself every time. And even if that's not something we deal with individually, perhaps we are concerned about our church. We despair and worry about the church's future. And it's not even just the church in Mount Tabor, it's the church. And this happens because we are influenced by the world around us. The culture tells us that we are too weak and we're too insignificant to really make a difference in this world. Despite our knowledge of God's work and blessings in our lives, it can be difficult to trust in God's belief in us. So it is all the more we need to hear these words to Ephesians this morning. We need to be reminded and to always remember that we are the blessed, chosen, adopted, and forgiven sons and daughters of God. We are part of God's family, the church. But here's the thing, it's not only about us as individuals. These opening words to the church in Ephesus remind us of that truth as well. Think about it this way. When you were young, or when we were young, and you stood at the edge of a pond, and there was a rock there, what would you do? You'd throw it in. I would. And would that rock just slip under the surface in the water without a trace? Of course not. It would hit the water and create a ripple of waves that would extend out across the pond for many feet and for several minutes. Being a disciple and working as the church, as a family, means not only that we are secure in our identity as the beloved of God, but also that we are engaged in making a difference for Christ in the world. We are Jesus' ripples. I will see it as Jesus is that rock. The rock hits the water, and we are Jesus' ripples. We are the ripples. We are the same as Jesus. We're trying to do the same thing. God's claim in our lives has to mean something. It has to ripple out into the world, touching the lives of others with the same blessing, forgiveness, and grace. God's blessing should never just hit us and then slip beneath the surface. It should change us. And in changing us, it should touch and change the lives of others with God's love. We aren't chosen for our own sake, but for the sake of what God wants to accomplish through us. You see, as soon as the writer is done reminding us of our identity in Christ, he launches us into the world and even the universe, announcing that in Christ we see God's plan to bring all things together in Christ, the things in heaven along with the things on earth. Just as we can have doubts and insecurities about ourselves, so too can we easily be tempted to believe that the earth and what is going on in the world is terribly dangerous. All we have to do these days is turn on the news, and we are hit with dire reports from our community and around the world. Jill was saying that they're putting water in the vaccines for India. If we take this text to heart, then we cannot give up hope in anyone or anything, in our neighborhood or in any nation. Just as God in Christ Jesus has called and claimed each one of us, just as we are made new by the love of God, so does our Lord have a plan to renew all things, every part of this world. Think with me for a moment. When you look at this world, what do you see as hopeless? That, what Jill told me, sounded hopeless about India. Is it impoverished children in our community and around the world? Is it wandering refugees with no resources and no homeland? Are there unsettled regions like Middle East or Africa where there is so much fighting that seems hopeless? Is it COVID, cancer, racism, man-made or natural disasters or addictions of any kind? How depressing. There is so much that is wrong in our world. It seems like every day there's some new problem or disaster. It's so easy for us to get caught up in all that negativity, to simply accept that things will always be bad. But what if we looked at the world with a different mindset, the glass half full? What if we had a childlike faith with which Christ himself describes? Suddenly our outlook on life changes, does it not? Suddenly, all that seems so desperate and hopeless is instead drawn up in the plan of God revealed in Christ. Suddenly, we can have hope that God will redeem all that bad, working good even from the horrendous and making all things new. I mean, this is the gospel story, right? That Christ will redeem and save this world. That's what makes it good news. There's nothing exciting about the good staying good. Instead, good news comes when the bad news is taken away and replaced by good. This is what Christ has done for each of us. And it is what God in Christ Jesus will do for the whole world. This is the ripple effect of the gospel. And God has even given us a down payment as proof that God is continually at work redeeming the world, bringing about good all around us. That's what we are told in the final sentences of this opening from Ephesians. We are sealed with the promised Holy Spirit because we believed in Christ. The writer says, the Holy Spirit is the down payment on our inheritance, which is applied toward our redemption as God's own people, resulting in the honor of God's glory. The Holy Spirit in our lives and in the life of the church is God's very own presence, leading and guiding us to our greater inheritance. The Spirit living within us, then, is a way of life, a life so lived that it results in the honor of God's glory. Here is the challenge for each of us and for this church that we love so much. We must be a people who see the good that God is doing in this world every day. And we must lift it up and celebrate God's good work at all times. Not only that, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, we must also be a part of God's redeeming activity. By being bearers of the good news and inviting people to join God's family. Sounds like another way of saying making disciples for Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Be Jesus' ripples. And as the blessing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, touches our lives, may they ripple out and touch this community and our whole world. We set our hope on Christ. Now, let us live that hope each day. Amen.
Amen.
Please join in the hymn, Do It Again.
Thank you. the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all God's works, and whose will is ever directed to God's children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of God's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the true truth of Christ, and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
And as always, we have our offering, which will be accepted here in church. You can mail it to our address, which is up on the board. We do Givelify, and you can also send it through UMC, GNJ, and you can send it to your local church through there. And our church does ministries here. We collect food. We do work with our youth. So please give to our church. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for all that you've given already, and it is very much appreciated. Please join me in the offertory prayer. Lord Jesus Christ,
thank you that you have plans for me that are for my good and your glory.
You said, give and it will be given to you. For in the same measure as you give, it will be given to you again. We give to you today as a response to your goodness to us.
We ask that you receive our offerings and continue to supply all our needs.
May your peace be in our hearts,
and your grace be in our words,
your love be in our hands, and your joy in our souls. In your mighty name, amen. And the final hymn today is, I'm Going to Live So.
Hope in Christ. Live for the praise of God's glory.
Go in peace in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.